I'll now show you some Cameroonian funerary ritual photographs. Well, anyway, you take your dead Cameroonian and you truss him up with bandages. You prop him up. Then you sit with him for a while. And you treat him with great respect. Making sure he's completely rigid. These, I think, are from the 1930s. Then you bury him sitting down and you put a pot over his head. Now, I've made all that up because the truth is, I don't know. But that's what I deduced from the pictures.
I would say it's a collection of primarily photographs, but manuscripts and objects as well. Some of them to do with narratives that are forgotten, and others to do with re-enlivening narratives that we know well, but maybe have only got a one-sided view of. So in a sense, it's a collection of stories. That's a typical pre-1940 German spine. What on earth is that? Dear, dear. That's an odd shaped album. Very curious 19th century German album.
How do you pay for it all?
How does anyone in the world pay for anything? You know, you just have to work. It's like, I can tell you like what you're doing, and you just have to make it, work. Sometimes some days are more easy than others, but once you get a sort of a momentum going, things will generally work. When you look through the lenses, it becomes three-dimensional.
Can you show how it works?
Yes, you just turn them round, then you focus, and then you see it in three dimensions. Very simple, but stereoscopic autochromes, we've got hundreds of them because it's a nice line. And you know, a lot of people scouring the world to look for what they think you're interested in, and quite often they get it completely wrong, and sometimes they get it so insanely right and you've never thought of it, and then you say thank you. Oh, these are not Bollywood, these are South Indian, different kind of curry. How about Lady James Bond? It's nice for me.
Can actually sometimes get a really fantastic unexpected thing, like sting of a bee. Something very small. This is a section of rush. That's about 100 years old, that's right.
You need to come out.
I wonder if I change the focus, would it change it? So that sharpens it up.
Yeah.
But if you look, take a look, if you can, through the lens, and you'll see that you need to be big. You're never going to guess what this is.
A bit of acute tuberculosis of the lung. It's a bit of syphilis. Pretty, huh?
So this year, for example, with the Caucasus photo collecting, I'm in a little flea market in Tbilisi in Georgia, and looking at some second-rate photos by Soviet period photos, and I start to talk to the man who's got his pitch, and he says, 20 years ago, I cleaned out the studio of the film poster production company in Georgia, and they've been in my cupboard ever since. So we go down some unlit lanes to an extraordinary falling down secessionist building. He said, my grandfather built this. We now only have a little part of it. He takes me into a room with, like, very typical, you know, just one light bulb and covered in dust, filth and objects everywhere. And he opens up the cupboard and it's all true. There's this extraordinary collection of 1950s and 60s Georgian, Soviet, Tajiki, Uzbeki, Dagestan film posters, and I spent hours and hours going. Most of them have got damage from insects, but you know, by the end of the day, I've pulled out 100 fantastic Cold War posters.
What is it with mine?
How's Jimmy doing?
Hello.
Oh, okay, I'll hang on.
It's working.
What lot are they on now?
We should leave it at 4, okay?
Okay. Wait. Leave it.
Okay, thanks, David. Talk to you soon.
We bought it.
Oh, no.
Oh, we pulled out. Okay.
Phew. Do you know how many photographs there are in total?
Not an exact number. But it's well in excess of 3 million. It's the main room and probably the main social space.
Sometimes we have nautical terms for the archive rooms, and this is the bridge.
So, yeah, we do a lot of editing and looking at stuff. If it was at Liverpool Football Club, it would be the boot room.
It's a private chat room.
Yeah, it's sometimes called the crow's nest.
Hundreds and hundreds of photo albums. They look a little bit like that. All neatly stored on the shelves.
And general reference to all different kinds of subjects in that.
Photography.
If anything, it makes everybody more sceptical about what they think history is when they see the primary source material. And then realise you can't trust primary source material because it's all skewed. I'd say we're in Eastern Europe in the late 1960s. Oh look, where are we? We've been long on these Cold War albums, which are pictures of people assembled around products, pointing, like you know, the dignitaries, and you know, they're totally boring, but once you get a kind of mass, you realise they're fascinating. So, oh, they're making a cranky aircraft. Look what they were making. It's terrific. Sometimes I just get hypnotised by the dress sense of... Funnily enough, my uncle was the minister for windmills in Poland, and he had 17 photo albums of opening windmills, which were all like that. Well, I got a phone call last year from a friend who was just trawling through the United States, and they were... just stumbled across 17 albums from an Afro-American policeman who'd over years documented his work colleagues in the nude walking around their houses, and he collaged the images together in the most fantastically careful and nice way, and like it was like someone's life's work, and clearly meant just for his, you know, it was something so personal and so true, and you know, life takes its turns, and it was for sale. So we purchased that, but you know, most family albums are personal in one way, and when they're made, people aren't imagining they're able to fit into a kind of history of photography. What's this? Looks like a Railway Trade Union album. I think it's the National Union of Railwaymen from England going for a visit to Russia. A works outing. Oh look, it looks like the Moscow Metro. That's sweet. Funny, we've hit on another Cold War one.
There's a box there that says IRA archive.
Ah, very distressing little archive, that one. There's a bomb disposal man who went mad. It's photos and letters and diaries, and you see the sad disintegration through stress of someone who was basically decent, but by events was driven to death in the end by... It's a tough one, that one.
Who uses the archive?
It sounds grumpy in a way, but the people who we all like to use the archive. People who are genuinely enthusiastic about the subject set, and you've got something to bring to the information, because there's not enough of us here to deal with it as a sort of site to be gawped at, or just to have curious visitors. We just don't have the infrastructure to deal with it. And you know, what would be the point anyway? So, I guess perceptive enthusiasts are people who, and you know, they could be from a kind of magazine building a film archive, or they might be from a library, they might be from an art gallery, they might be from a museum, they might be from, you know, from anywhere. And never two the same.